Good morning, committee, and welcome to members of the public joining us today, both in person and online. This is the 17th of November 2022 meeting of the Western and Southern Area Planning Committee, which is one of the three area-based planning committees of the Dorset Council. Our area of remit covers the previous Weymouth and Portland Borough Council and most of the previous West Dorset District Council areas. The Planning Committee is not a public meeting, but a meeting in which the public are invited. All attendees must comply with the ruling of the chair. They must not interrupt the meeting or cause undue disturbance. To support this, please switch off your mobile phones or select silent mode for the duration of the meeting. Members of the public are allowed to record or film any part of the meeting. However, they should conform to the protocol for filming an audio recording of public council meetings and not distract the proceedings. Those filming should only focus on those directly involved in the conduct of the meeting. Also, the meeting is being live streamed and a copy of the recording will be available to view on the council website following the meeting. No fire alarm test is expected. If the fire alarm sounds, can all present leave the building as quickly as possible by way of the closest exit and follow the directions to the nearest assembly point away from the civic offices. Public amenities can be located in the foyer of County Hall adjacent to the entrance. Members of the public who have given advance notice of their wish to speak on an application will be invited to address the committee for a maximum of 3 minutes. No material is to be circulated to members of the committee. For the benefit of the public, my name is Councillor David Shortell, a chairman of this area planning committee, and my vice chairman is Councillor Bill Pipe. Good morning, Bill.
Good morning, Chairman. Good morning, everybody.
Introducing other members of the committee, Councillor Dave Bellwell. Good morning, Dave.
Good morning,
good morning to you. Councillor Kelvin Clayton. Good morning, Kelvin. Councillor Susan Cocking. Good morning, Susan.
Apologies, Chairman.
That's all right. Councillor Jean Dunseth, good morning. Good morning to you. Councillor Nick Ireland.
Apologies, Chairman.
Right. Councillor Paul Kimber, good morning, Paul. Good morning to you. Councillor Louis O'Leary, good morning, Louis.
Good morning,
good morning to you. Councillor Kate Weller, good morning, Kate.
Good morning.
Good morning. Councillor Sarah Williams, good morning, Sarah.
Good morning.
Good morning. And Councillor John Worth, good morning, John. Good morning to you. Officers involved in the meeting include Anne Collins, Area Manager, Western and Southern Team, Hannah Massey, our lawyer, Katrina Trevitt, Team Leader, Robert Parr, Planning Officer, Elaine Tibble, Democratic Service Officer, Josh Kennedy, Democratic Services Apprentice. Good morning, Josh. Good morning to you. Item one on the... Item one on the agenda to confirm any apologies for absence. I understand we've got two.
Yeah, thank you. We have two apologies from Councillor Susan Cocking and Nick Ireland.
Thank you for that. Item two on the agenda. To confirm the minutes of the meeting held on the 13th of October 2022. Has all members received a copy of those minutes?
Yes, Chairman.
Thank you. If members are content, I will sign those minutes as a true record of what took place. Thank you. Thank you. Item three on the agenda, declarations of interest. Does any member have any declaration of pecuniary or other conflict of interest, bias or predetermination regarding any item on the agenda? Right, who's first?
Yeah, as a member of Bridport Town Council, I will declare an interest and leave room for application 5A.
Thank you, Sarah.
As a member of Weymouth Town Council, there are two applications that I declare an interest on and will leave the room.
Councillor Clayton.
Yes, Chair. Item 5A, I'm also a member of the Town Council.
Thank you.
Councillor Bowell, Chairman.
Councillor Bowell.
Yes, Chair, likewise, I'm a member of Bridport Town Council, so for item 5A, I will leave the room. I would also like to declare predetermination for item 5D in Bothinhampton. I tried very hard to get the outline planning permission to committee and it was refused, so I can, with a clear conscience, stay in the room when the application is being discussed. Thank you.
Councillor O'Leary.
Thank you, Chairman. Although I'm not a member of any town council, I'm currently a candidate in the election period and therefore I understand I'm governed by the rules of Purdah. So I'll take that into account during this meeting, but I'm not predetermined on any application currently coming up.
Thank you for that. Okay, item 4 on the agenda, public participation. Only those people who have registered to speak with Democratic Services will be invited to address the committee. The order of speaking will normally be the first three in objection and the first three in support, including the applicant or agent. If a ward councillor who is not a member of the committee wishes to address the meeting, they will be allowed 3 minutes to do so. Neither the objectors or supporters will normally be questioned, except to clarify a point of fact by the chairman. All written statements received by Democratic Services have been passed to members prior to this meeting. We'll now take item 5 on the agenda, planning applications. We have 7 planning applications before us today for consideration. A comfort break of 5 or 10 minutes will be taken as and when is requested. Now. Right, the first item on the agenda is 5A, and before we actually take that item, can I ask the three members as specified there? They predetermined what I was going to say. Okay, so those have now left the room. We're now going to take item 5A on the agenda, and that's an application number PFUL 2022-03511, Station Yard Car Park, Station Yard West Bay, DT65EW. And that's for the erection of a disabled changing room extension to existing public toilets. I now invite Robert Parr, the case officer, to introduce this item. Over to you, Robert.
Morning, councillors. So the application before us this morning is brought to the council as it's Dorset Council land, and therefore under the schedule of delegation, it's been brought to committee for determination. As mentioned, the application is by Bridport Town Council, and it's at Station Road Car Park at West Bay for the erection of disabled changing room extension to the existing public toilets. So we've got here a location plan just for context, and we have, I'll just get my pointer working a second. We have the old railway station to the south, the play area, existing play area to the north, and this is the line of the old railway with the toilets just on at the side of that. There's an aerial photograph just shows you the context again. You can see it's sort of set quite within quite a sort of a urban area of car parking, but on the edge of the countryside. We've got a block plan, just shows indicates the sort of the extent of the extension in the existing shape of the building, which is a little ununiform. This is an illustration of the existing floor plan. So we have the ladies' toilets on the left. the gents, the 24-hour and the disabled toilets on the right of the building in a separate block. And the two blocks are linked by a canopy, which forms where access is formed. There's also a cycle rack, covered cycle rack at the rear of the build, the ladies' toilet block. Here we've just got an image so you can see what the existing building looks like. You can see it's stone walls with timber cladding above. And there's the bike rack at the rear and an entrance here on the right-hand side. There's a view of the entrance to the toilets with the covered canopy. And like I say, ladies, and this on the left-hand side is where the extension is intended to go. I have a proposed plan. You can see the extension would project out from the ladies' block towards the south and would be approximately 5.1 metres long and 3.6 metres deep, and would provide toilet, shower, and have a hoist in it so that people with disabilities could be lifted out and use the facilities. Here we have the south and the west elevation, which shows the extension would be attached, if you like, to the existing roof to make it no longer a monopitch but a dual pitch roof. Again, matching materials with timber and above and stone below. And then on the south-facing elevation, which where the access point would be, there'd be six solar panels, which would help to power the running of the lights in the building. There's a cross-section of the proposed extension with the joist and the accessible changing room, and then the east elevation there on the right. So the proposals are considered and supported in principle as they would be an enhancement of local facility, community building. The design is supported, the materials are in harmony, and the design is in harmony with the existing building and the site in general. No highway concerns have been raised, and there'd be no ecology issues or impact on ecology. As the site's in quite an isolated location, there'd be no adverse impact on amenity. And therefore, we're recommending a grant of the permission subject to conditions for commencement plans and just to confirm the external materials. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Robert. Are there any questions of a technical nature for the case officer? Councillor Kimber.
Okay, I've got the red band now. I've got a hearing aid, so you can always get that. I just wanted to ask one question, not that technical, but we spoke about 24-hour toilets. Will this be 24-hour as well? I'm thinking of the needs of the disabled. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Kimber. Now, can I pass back to Robert for...
Unfortunately, I've not been, I'm not sure that's detailed in the application. It's something we could look into. I think the only normal 24-hour toilets is the 24-hour toilet. The rest of them usually are shut, I think, at other times outside normal sort of hours of the day. So, yeah.
Does that satisfy your question?
I can add to that, Chair.
Okay.
Well, I wish it was 24-hour, but...
It's available by
Always available by a key, thank you. That's
okay. Councillor Pipe.
Thank you, Chairman. There are already existing 24-hour toilets there. But I'm not, like the officer says, I'm not sure whether the new build will be 24-hour changing rooms, but are there toilets within the changing rooms as well?
Toilet in the changing rooms, Councillor.
I suspect that would be a natural follow-on, that they would be 24 hours, but we'll see. Councillor O'Leary, Chairman.
Councillor O'Leary.
Yeah, sorry, Chairman, it's not a technical question, but it just saves us all some time. Can I just propose this? It just seems like a no-brainer.
Yes. Proposal from Councillor O'Leary, Chairman.
Thank you.
Chairman, I'd like to second this recommendation, please.
Thank you, Councillor Dancy. We've got anyone else wishing to speak? Well, we've got a proposer and a seconder, right? We now take a vote by a show of hands. All those in favour? Thank you. That is unanimously passed by the committee. Thank you very much. That completes this particular item. Thank you, Councillor O'Leary. We're operating under the new code of conduct, which requires members who's shown a predetermination to actually leave the room for a short period of time so that there is no hint of any influence on the debate or vote.
Members may stay for the public section so they can hear the officer's report and they may speak if they have registered to do so, but they will need to leave the room for the debate and the vote.
Thank you, members. Right, we'll now take the next item on the agenda, and that is item 5B, and that's the application number PFUL 2022-04600, Beach Control Office, the Esplanade, Weymouth, Dorset, DT4, 7 a.m. And this is for the installation of two roof-mounted solar arrays on the south and west-facing walls, south and west-facing roof slopes. I now invite Bob Parr, the case officer, to introduce this. Back to you.
Thank you, Chairman. So we have another application on Dorset Council land, hence it's being brought before committee and the scheme of delegation for determination. The application is by Weymouth Town Council And the site is, as you said, Chairman, on the beach control office on the Esplanade. Here we have the site, if on the Esplanade, next to the beach, approximately 100 metres south of the memorial clock. An aerial photograph of it. Apologies, this is a little bit dated because there's been the new extension projecting out towards the beach in recent times. This is the most up-to-date image we've got. You can see it's close to the road and the beach and quite an urban area. Help provide some context, we've got a view, street scene view looking southeast. And a street scene view looking northeast. Existing roof plan. And there we can see on the two elevations, the proposed solar array. And there again on the south elevation. So in total, there are 9 panels proposed on the south facing roof slope and 17 panels proposed on the west facing roof slope. Got an elevation of the north and east of the building is existing. Unsurprisingly, it's very much the same because there's nothing proposed on the north and east, so it would stay the same. South and west elevations existing. And then the plan showing the south and west elevations with the panels attached. They're on the west and above on the south. Again, we would consider this to be a improvement to a community facility and would help to contribute towards cutting our greenhouse gases. The proposed design is supported as it's considered to be in harmony with this existing building and in keeping the site and the area in general. No highways concerns have been raised and there'd be not considered to be any impact on ecology or wildlife and no adverse impact on amenity. Therefore, we're recommending grant permission subject to conditions for timing and plans. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you very much indeed. Could I ask you to help me talk a little? Does she need to go?
Only once we reach the debate.
Okay.
Technical questions.
Committee, are there any technical questions for the case officer, please? No? Thank you.
No questions, Chairman.
I now open the debate to she needs to leave. Now open the debate for discussion, but before we do, could I ask you to retire for a short while, please, sir?
Okay. We're asking you to retire.
Unfortunately not. Okay. Councillor Pike.
No questions, Chairman, but I'd like to move the recommendation, go for the vote.
Okay. I'm happy to second that, Chair.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak? We've now got a proposal and a which has been duly seconded. We'll now take a vote by a show of hands. All those in favour? That again has been...
Yes, I did.
Yeah, that again has been carried unanimously. The committee has voted unanimously in favour. Right, for the record, Councillor Weller and Councillor O'Leary has remained outside until the completion of this particular item, which is 5C on the agenda, and that's the application number PFUL 2022-04176. Lodmore Country Park, Main Car and Coach Park with the public toilets in Greenhill, Weymouth, DT47SX. And that's for the, asked to install 15 panel roof mounted solar arrays. And again, I now invite Robert Parr, the case officer, to introduce this item. Back to you, Robert.
Thank you again, Chairman. So as members may be guessing, there's a bit of a theme running through this morning's applications. And here we have another application on Dorset Council land, and therefore under the scheme of delegation, it's brought to committee for determination. As mentioned, this is at Lodmore Country Park, the main car and coach park toilets, and the installation of 15 panel roof mounted solar array. Here we have a site location plan. You see the toilets are located in the middle of the car park area, with the Lodmore Public House to the southeast, and the Premier Inn Hotel located there to the southwest. An aerial photograph of the site for context. This is located, surrounded by car parking almost. This is a sort of 3D aerial perspective, which I thought would help provide some context for members. And we can see the roof where the solar array would be mounted. Here we have plan, existing roof plan, and there you can see on the southwest elevation the 15 panels of solar panels. Existing elevation drawings, and there we can see in the middle the solar array mounted on the southwest roof. So, in summary, again, it would be considered an enhancement to a local community building, helping to run the electricity and make it more sustainable. The design is supported, as it's considered in harmony with the existing building and the site and the area in general. No highways concerns raised, and no ecology issues highlighted. Due to its isolated location, we don't consider this to be any adverse impact on amenity. And therefore, recommending the application is granted, subject to conditions, again, timing and plans. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you for that. Are there any questions of a technical nature for the case officer? Thank you. Thank you.
We have a late arrival in Councillor John Worth.
Proposed? Councillor Kimber. Happened a second.
Get out.
Okay, no one else wishing to speak? Right, this particular item has been duly proposed and seconded. I'll now take a vote by show of hands. All those in favour? That particular item has been unanimously carried by the committee. Thank you for that. Right, okay. We'll now take item 5D on the agenda. And I understand that you've shown predetermination, so ask if you would mind moving across, Councillor Bell. Thank you very much. Yeah, okay. Okay, this is application number PRES, a reserve item, 2022-03490, land south of Langdon Green, Marrowbone Lane, Buttonhampton, Bridport, DT64BU. Notice for the erection of one dwelling with access, reserve matters application to determine appearance, landscape, layout and scale following the grant of outline planning permission number WDD20002660. I now invite Katrina Trevitt, the case officer, to introduce this item. Over to you, Katrina.
Thank you, Chairman. So, yes, this application is applying for reserve matters to determine the appearance, landscaping, layout and scale following the grant of outline planning permission to site a single dwelling on the application site. Details of access were previously approved as part of that outline planning application. The site location is within the southeastern part of Buttonhampton Village. It's a dead-end lane, basically, which leads out of the village to a farmstead at the bottom of the lane, spreading out to the AOMB beyond it. There you can see in the red line the application site, which is 0.16 hectares. To the north is the applicant's bungalow of Langdon Green, and so the site sits below this within the existing topography. Members should note that as part of the outline planning permission originally granted, an indicative plan was added to that planning permission. There was no restriction on the height of the proposed dwelling through condition, and therefore it was for later interpretation by the applicant and agent as to how the appearance and scale of the dwelling was to come forward as part of that reserve matters application. Members should be aware that the indicative plan, so basically the floor area for the proposed dwelling, was agreed as part of that outline planning application. So there is an indicative floor area that was added to that earlier approval. Here is the aerial photograph of the site. Apologies for it not being redlined, but you can broadly see the application plot sitting below that of Langdon Green on the lane, with the farmstead at the bottom of the lane and the various bungalows in linear form as you pass along the lane. So again, here's a clearer block plan of the application showing the proposed siting of the two-storey dwelling and the proposed garage. There's intended to be native hedgerows and landscaping and significant area for parking to the site. You'll also notice that the house is set back in, so it's not directly onto the lane with suitable access, which was obviously previously agreed, also shown. This is the proposed finished scale of the dwelling for the application. As you can see, when the application was originally submitted, there were concerns over the height and bulk. However, amended plans have been received, which reduce the roof height and the eaves, kind of setting these windows in as dormers, just trying to bring that subservience in, really. So it does appear as a modest dwelling within the lane. You've obviously then got a single-storey outshot here at the rear. In terms of the AOMB impact and the main concerns that were originally raised by the Town Council clearly expressed concern ongoing for the development of this site, which you can see there's a caravan in the middle there. So this is the site we're talking about here, and you've got Langdon Green to the north there. The Bridport Town Council had concerns about developing, again, the principle of development of the Greenfield site. However, that's already been established through the outline planning permission. They also had concerns about the inclusion of a two-storey dwelling on this lane, when in the majority there appears to be bungalows. However, in terms of this, I want to draw to your attention the fact that this development here at the top of the lane is actually called the Paddocks. This is actually two-storey. This is Glenhaven, the neighbouring property to the south. When you look at that, you couldn't actually determine whether it's single-storey or two-storey. You look at these, the hillside, again, it kind of plays to the strength of the site in that the two storeys is actually mitigated because of the hillside, the topography, the rising topography, and actually how those bungalows step down that hillside. Which, you know, is obviously why, in principle, with the outline planning permission, it was considered acceptable, and actually it would follow the rhythm and line down that hill. You've also got, which you can't see from here, but I'll show in a photo in a moment, the two-storey farmhouse at the bottom of the lane as well. I want to also pick out, actually, one of the bungalows, which is, this is basically two doors up from where the application site will be, because you'll see in the section plan in a moment how that relates to the proposed dwelling in terms of height. So just for the committee's benefit, this is Langdon Green, which is the bungalow directly north. You can see the height differences we're talking about here. This picture is taken from the lane, as is with this one, which is the next neighbour up from Langdon Green. So this is another bungalow. This is a picture of the Paddocks, which is actually at the top of the lane. So this is the range of two-storey cottage-type dwellings on the lane, but at the top. And this is a blurry picture of the farmhouse, but there is another one here. So again, it's just pointing out that there is evidence of two-storey dwellings on the lane. And I think this is probably the most important plan, because this is the section plan throughout the site, which clearly shows that the ridge of Langdon Green, that bungalow to the north, is significantly higher than the proposed ridge of the two-storey dwelling, but also in comparison, that the agent has actually shown indicative here, is that a chalet bungalow, that chalet bungalow that I mentioned earlier, which is two or three doors up, is actually higher at a finishing height than the proposed dwelling that we're considering today. And therefore, if the committee wished to express a bungalow, you know, that's the type of height that has already been achieved in the lane. And therefore, actually, the proposed dwelling being put forward is subservient to that. It's lower. So it's important to see how the land, you know, how they've worked with the land, basically. It's dropping the overall sense of prominence of the two-storey dwelling, as is the set-in nature of that dwelling back from the lane, and the topography and the resulting height of neighbouring, you know, the neighbouring Langdon Green bungalow in relation to this house. This is just a photo, actually, of that chalet bungalow that's higher than the proposed dwelling that we're considering today. And this is a photo I took again on a very rainy morning, but you can see Glenhaven, which is the bungalow to the south. You can see Langdon Green to the top here. What you won't be able to see is the proposed dwelling, because actually when you look up this lane, it's so far set in that it will be set back in to this, and so therefore the view will be relatively obscured. So overall, we consider that because of the topography, because of the limited height of the dwelling, because of other examples of two-storey dwellings or very high chalet bungalows within the lane, we consider that actually the impact on visual amenity with the AOMB and the natural beauty of the AOMB is safeguarded. There is no significant impact. In terms of neighbouring amenity, there were concerns regarding overlooking. But let me just take you back through to the block plan a moment. What you can't see, let me just show this actually on aerial view, is that there is a 45 metre difference. There's also a significant land drop to this neighbour to the south who expressed concerns about impact on their amenity. Also, their entire garden area is to the south of their dwelling, and therefore it's completely obscured by the orientation, the position, the height and distance of the proposed dwelling to that neighbour. So to continue, we consider that the neighbour amenity impact is acceptable. They have included the required biodiversity mitigation that was put forward as part of the biodiversity plan at outline stage. And obviously the access was already agreed at outline stage. That's already in place. And we consider there is sufficient and suitable parking arrangements for the proposed dwelling. Therefore, we're recommending granting planning permission subject to conditions. And those are the standard plans list condition, approval of finishing materials, approval of soft landscaping and planting, trees and hedgerow protection, and ensuring no meter boxes on the front of the dwelling. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Katrina. I now invite Mr. Simon Ludgate, the agent for the applicant, to address the committee. Please speak directly into the microphone. You have 3 minutes. Over to Mr. Ludgate.
Thank you, Chairman. Haven't got a lot to say on this application. To emphasise the principle that the establishment of a dwelling on this site was granted in the outline consent. We've put a two-storey building on the site because we think it fits the topography very well. But we were mindful of the comments from neighbours and from the parish council about the prominence of the building, and we have made amendments to lower it still further in the ground and provide evidence, photographic, to show that it will work on this site. I don't think there will be any significant damage to the area of outstanding natural beauty. I have walked the hills around there many times, and I know this site well, and I feel that what we're proposing will fit in well. I therefore hope that you will be able to support the recommendation of your officer on this application. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ludgate. I now call on Katrina Trevitt to respond with any salient points she may wish to clarify.
Councillor Williams, Chairman, Councillor Clayton, and Councillor Kimber.
Mike, Councillor Williams first then. Over to you, Councillor Williams.
Question is to the planning officer. She's mentioned Bridport Town Council as the respondee to this. It did not go to Bridport Town Council. It went to Bovenhampton Parish Council. Can your planning officer confirm this, please?
Yes. For that, it was heard by Bovenhampton Parish Council, so apologies for that.
Does that change anything?
Are you happy with that, Councillor Williams?
Yeah, I
am happy with that. It's just I wanted that record made, because otherwise we might have had to declare an interest on it. Thank you.
Councillor Burwell, you are next.
Thank you, Chair. I was going to say the same thing about as Sarah said, just for clarification. My second question was, I'm not quite sure how to word this. The officers made a point of saying that the indicative site plan showing approximate position and floor area limits was approved at outline stage, even though we're here to determine layout and scale. So as a general question, is that standard practice that that is agreed at outline stage?
Yeah, as you can appreciate, we ask for an indicative site plan so you can approximate the potential impact on neighbours and potential issues when you're dealing with that outline application. Otherwise, the decision would be relatively completely blind in terms of, you could have a very large site, but you're trying to make a decision on approximately where that, you know, where that dwelling could go. So yes, it has been standard practice to ask for an indicative site plan so we can, you know, fully consider as much as we can. I mean, obviously, you know, if there was significant concerns regarding neighbour amenity impact, it might have been that we felt it necessary to condition like the resulting height, or that we ensure that the proposed dwelling was only a certain floor area to try and kind of obviously limit that impact. But we do suggest there is the submission of a site plan so we can broadly see the parameters of what we're dealing with.
Does that answer your question, Councillor? Okay.
Yes, just roughly, to how far can that vary then? Once the indicative area has been determined at outline stage, to what extent can that vary at this stage?
Yes, in this case, the siting, height, scale, they weren't actually determined at outline stage. There are no conditions on the permission that says it has to be in accordance with that. So we do still have full control over scale, layout, appearance, and any other reserve matters.
Okay.
Councillor Kimber, Chairman.
Councillor Kimber, over to you.
Oh, thank you very much, Chair. I've got the red light. I wonder if we could go back to the cottage or the proposed building itself. I just wanted to ask a question regarding when we go to these beautiful Dorset villages, there really is, you've got the feeling that you're in a village and a wonderful village setting. I just wondered, is there any urgency to try and get that setting right as other particular houses? I know there are some new bungalows in that area, but I just wondered if with some of the older properties, it gives you that rural Dorset village. And I just wondered at that stage, I know you've done a lot of work in bringing down the height, but whether that is taken into consideration as well. Thank you.
Could you answer that question, Katrina?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, what I would mention in terms of that is that there's no set uniform style, there's no set approach to this lane in terms of the bungalows and the properties. They all vary in form and scale and appearance, and therefore it's very hard in this instance to actually pick out anything of particular merit to copy. And I have to say, they're not actually particularly, they're not particularly visually aesthetic. Let's put it like that. You know, they've been considerably, a couple of them have clearly been extended and developed We have to also bear in mind we do have replacement dwelling policy, which each of those bungalows could apply for that. And we would have to consider very carefully about, you know, if we would have concerns about that. So that's also something that could come forward. And to be fair, the proposed dwelling, they have incorporated natural stone, the brick, coloured render. You know, they've tried to take reference from a modern cottage, if you like. And I have to say, from my perspective, I couldn't see anything that would, you know, that could be further enhancing from that. There isn't, you know, and unfortunately, that's because of the housing stock and the bungalows that are already there that aren't particularly visually pleasing. In my consideration, however. There we go.
Thank you, Katrina. I'm sure that there are many very pleasing-looking properties in Bothenhampton. does that answer your question? Go back to you. Anyone else wishing to ask a question? Okay, right. If there's no more deliberate, if everyone's happy, I will now go into general debate. Is there anyone wishing to speak?
Councillor O'Leary. O'Leary, Chairman.
Councillor O'Leary, thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to propose approval of this application, please.
Thank you. We've got a proposition, a proposal, sorry. Does anyone wishing to second that proposition? Yeah, okay, thank you.
Well, who was that?
Yes. Councillor Pike.
Yes.
Seconded.
I think a second, Chairman.
Yeah, we've got a proposition and duly seconded. Does anyone else wish to speak? Then I will put it to the vote. All those in favour of acceptance? Thank you. Any against? Any abstentions? Right. For the benefit of the public, seven members of the committee voted in favour, none against, two abstain. Please. Welcome back, Councillor Bowell. Right, we'll now take item 5E on the agenda. That's an application for installation of one in number illuminated hanging box sign and one in number bump top sign. And this is in association with the next item on the agenda, item 5F, for the same place, for the same residence, 116, the Esplanade, Weymouth, Dorset, and that it covers the facility, the installation of the internal and external signage on a public listed building. Thank you. Okay. Now, we're having one presentation, but the votes will be taken separately. So I'm now going to hand back to Katrina do a presentation. Back to you.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, so this is a single presentation for both advertisement consent and listed building consent for 116 the Esplanade. The application's being brought to Planning Committee because Dorset Council are the freehold owners of the property. So, otherwise known as the Lawrence of Arabia Hotel, this application site is a beachfront Esplanade hotel in Weymouth. You can see there the red line plan. and here the site plan just showing the property fronting onto the esplanade. And this application seeks signage for that frontage to include a non-illuminated sticker sign above the door and a non-illuminated plaque sign to the front, and also an internally illuminated light box to the front elevation. Here's just the aerial view of that site. And so just to reflect on the key constraints, it's a Grade 2 listed building. It is within the Weymouth Town Centre Conservation Area, within the DDB, and as I've already mentioned, Dorset Council own the land. Here's a photo of the front of the property at the moment. The vinyl sticker that's proposed on the glass above the door is already in place. So you can see it there in place at the moment. The next plan actually shows the proposed location for the frontage plaque sign here, which will be mounted on the existing wooden brackets that were holding up this previous sign here. And then the internally illuminated light box will be situated above the plaque sign here. This is just some detailing of the illuminated light box announcing the hotel. You can see there. This is the detail of the plaque sign being affixed to the front wall. This is actually for the benefit of the listed building consent, which is the only matter differing in the consideration here between the two applications. This is an internal sign that's being affixed to the wall just inside the entrance of the hotel. So that relates to the listed building consent only. And here's some photos that I took just of the neighbouring hotels, actually. This is the next door neighbour, who's also got the similar vinyl sticker above the door. They've also got the light box advert in place. You can also see also a further couple of doors down, similar signage, with the plaque and the light box in place. And this is just a photo looking down that street. So you can see this is something which we've obviously, you know, has been accepted before and is in place in terms of the advertisement consent, which only considers public safety and amenity. It's set well back from the footpath. It's clearly not going to interfere with people that are passing. Set above and at height here. And in terms of amenity, the signage is considered to be very modest, well-scaled, and therefore not considerable, but clearly bringing attention to that, to the Esplanade Hotel, and improving their business prospects in terms of that and getting some replacement signage put up. And so therefore, in terms of the advertisement consent, like I've said, we consider that the visual impact is and the amenity impact is acceptable, with no harm to the Grade 2 listed building and no harm to the Weymouth Town Centre Conservation Area. Highways have no objection. I've already reflected on that public safety impact and it being set back and higher, so it won't interfere with pedestrians or path users. And therefore, we are, just to reflect also on the listed building consent. Yes, as I've already mentioned, there's considered to be no harm to the actual listed building from the proposal. And therefore, we're recommending a grant of planning permission, of advertisement consent, considering that the proposed signage and lit illumination, just to reflect on the illumination, it's considered a discrete form of illumination, which is acceptable. And therefore, we are recommending the grant subject to the plans list condition that the signs will not be illuminated outside the hours of 7 a.m. to 11 p.m. each day. And then the other conditions are the standard advertisement conditions, which relate to things such as if the sign were removed, you know, the building, or it was removed in a safe way and the building restored, etc., things like that. In terms of the listed building consent, we're also recommending a grant of listed building consent subject to a plans list condition, 3 years standard time limit condition, and that the existing cabling is to be used for the light box along with the existing holes and timber battening to ensure there's no further impact on that historic fabric to the front of the building. We reuse where we can. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Katrina. Right, are there any questions of a technical nature for the case of...
Councillor O'Leary, Chairman.
Councillor O'Leary.
Sorry, it's non-technical, but I'd like to speak as soon as it goes to debate.
Have we got any technical questions for the case officer on either of those applications? I would to Councillor Bill Pike.
Thank you, Chairman. The sign's not to be illuminated between 7 o'clock in the morning and 11 o'clock at night. All right, turn it off at 11.
Yeah.
Oh, right, okay. I misread. Thank you.
Councillor Weller, Chairman.
Is this a technical question, Councillor Weller? All right, okay. No more technical questions? Then I will enter into debate. Councillor O'Leary.
Yes, yeah, this is the Lawrence of Arabia Hotel in loving memory of Peter O'Toole. I'd like to propose this for approval. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'll do that in a moment.
Happy to second, Chairman.
Councillor Weller is happy to second. Okay, now we've got a proposal and a seconder for the first application, the advertising application, because we're taking a proposal and a seconder for the listed building consent separately. Okay, so this is the first application. Right, we've got a proposal and a seconder. Anyone else wishing to speak? Then I'll take a vote by show of hands. All those in favour? Okay, that's unanimous. Thank you very much indeed. And now we're going to take the second part of this particular application, which is the listed building consent. Can I have a proposer and a seconder? Same two?
Yeah.
Okay. Proposed by Councillor O'Leary, seconded by Councillor Kate Weller. Anyone wishing to speak? No, in that case, I'll take a vote by a show of hands. All those in favour? Carried. Again, unanimously decided by the committee. Okay, all right, onwards and upwards. We now take the next item on the agenda, item 5G, application PFUL 2022-05448. I know that's different on the agenda. The boat, DSK2 kiosk opposite 41 to 42, the Esplanade, Weymouth. Use of beach to extend existing decking area. And again, I hand over to Katrina. Over to you, Katrina.
Thank you, Chairman. Yes, so this application is proposing planning permission to further extend an existing decking area over the existing beach. The application is brought to Planning Committee because of Dorset Council owning the land. Here is the site location, just showing the cafe kiosk on the front of the beach, which was it was originally put in as part of the seafront regeneration project roughly about 10 years ago. And what they're seeking to do is to extend the decking, which currently allows patrons of the kiosk and cafe to sit out and enjoy their beverages. This is an aerial plan of the boat kiosk right here on the frontage, so you can see its position. And basically, effectively, what the decking will do is extend out by 4 metres and square off, basically. However, it will be at a lower tier, which I'll explain in a moment. Here is a picture of the front of that kiosk, the boat. Here is the plan just showing how the decking is going to come out and extend out and cover. You'll also see the two sets of steps, actually, which will provide access from the original tier of decking. It's a bit of a spot the difference in terms of the plans because the changes are so minimal and so modest. So the existing elevations are at the top here and the proposed elevations at the bottom. And you will literally see the decking, which is going to basically level up on that beach area at the lower tiers. So you'll see this line going across, and this is where it will spread out. And then this is just a photo of obviously the upper tier of the decking and the rear. So the new area of decking will be off of these steps on the bottom here over the beach area. Now, there were concerns raised by the conservation officer just about further kind of increasing the scale of that decking in terms of the conservation area impact. However, realistically, from a distance, I think in the majority, if it's not covered in sand, I think you're probably likely to only see the people sat out on the decking as a level surface, to be honest. So it's considered that actually, having weighed that in the planning balance, we consider there is no harm to the Weymouth Town Centre conservation area and the setting of one of the esplanade buildings behind. And therefore, the principle supported in under policy SUS 2 of the adopted local plan, as I've already mentioned, we consider that there is no harm to the Weymouth Town Centre conservation area and that it will be preserved. And visual amenity impact, given its very low level, it will be hard to decipher it, I think, from the beach, certainly in distance views. And therefore, we consider the visual amenity impact acceptable. There's also, the additional benefits to the existing business in terms of allowing them to extend and make better how they run. So there's the economic benefits of the scheme. And it is within a flood zone 2 area. However, the cafe use is a less vulnerable use, and we consider that the proposal will not increase flood risk at the site or elsewhere. Therefore, we're recommending a grant of planning permission subject to conditions relating to the 3-year standard time limit, plans list, and that the timber to be used for the decking extension shall be similar in colour and texture to the existing decking for the benefits of the visual appearance of the development. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Katrina. Are there any questions of a technical nature for the case officer?
Councillor Bowell, Chair.
Councillor Bowell.
Thank you, Chair. I like the scheme. Could I just ask why the access down to the decking is steps only? Is there no thought about a ramp for wheelchairs?
Thank you, Councillor. Yes. In terms of that access, I agree. When I first looked at it, I thought, there's only steps down to this. However, what I would say is that, those that are able to access it, it will actually, give better access for the people on the level area top tier of decking to be able to actually have the greater benefit of being at that level access at the top. And so those that can actually access the bottom tier will be able to go down to the bottom tier. The applicant hasn't been approached to provide a ramp access down. However, they could, if the committee felt it necessary to achieve that. I suppose the trouble is that it is going to be level with the beach. And therefore, as I mentioned previously about the sand, that's something that you also have to take into consideration if you were, for say wheelchair access and things, in terms of moving about on that realistically. And I think the way it's been proposed is that it is, as modest as possible, but clearly, it's kind of to align in with the beach without, sticking out and being a further projection at height. So I think the way it's been designed is to limit its kind of visual impact, really. And I presume that, people sit out on the beach and, you know, we've all experienced it, haven't we, where you sat there and you're not particularly level, or and it does seem to be undulating in terms of that decking, in terms of photos. So it's literally to provide that kind of level setting for people that wish to be able to eat out there. But yeah.
Thank you, Katrina. Does that answer your question, Kat?
He wants to come back, Chair.
You want to come back?
Yes, please, Chair. Yeah, thank you for the explanation. I don't actually 100% agree with it. No disrespect. At West Bay, we've actually paid for matting to go down onto the beach, the town council, an awful lot of money, so that we can have wheelchairs down on the beach for the first time. And it's been well received in West Bay. And I just feel that we're missing an opportunity here. By all I'm asking for is just one of those sets of steps to be a ramp. We're trying to include people onto the beach. In fact, we're even trying to get wheelchairs with big tires so that we can get wheelchairs onto the beach in West Bay. And I think we're missing a trick here on this one. So it's only a small change, and I'm totally for the whole project, no problem at all. But I just wish that we could actually condition this to have a ramp there for inclusivity for wheelchairs. Thank you.
Do you have any comment on that at all, Katrina?
That is something that we could consider. I think for the benefit of the applicants, though, it would be worth delegating authority, subject to the applicant's agreement, obviously, of putting in the ramp and getting that designed in. And then we could seek to take it forward in that way.
Councillor Weller, Chairman.
Next person on my list is Councillor Weller. Councillor Weller.
Thank you very much, Chairman. In answer to Councillor Bowles' question, I hope you will endorse this, Katrina, the height between the two isn't terribly high, and therefore any ramp would be lethal, I think, if you're in a wheelchair or a buggy coming down from it. There is a ramp from the prom onto the sands very close by, and Weymouth does have some decking areas that they place in different places. So that's certainly a conversation that could be had with Weymouth Town Council. We do also have large-wheeled, the ball wheelchairs available to people in Weymouth already. So the disabled angle has been covered fairly fully. The steps are there already because there are access onto the sands. To make a ramp of a suitable height would mean removing, I think, quite a lot of the existing decking in order to achieve it. And it wouldn't achieve an awful lot. It wouldn't be worth the business's time or money. You know, it wouldn't be beneficial to them to go to that expense, I don't think. It's a very popular cafe. It's used 12 months of the year. You will see people sitting out there on Christmas Day and Boxing Day. So it's extraordinarily popular. Adding this extra space is an extra amenity and a very useful amenity, particularly useful for people with children, because children tend to play on the sands whilst Granny is sitting at the upper level. Granny will be opposite at the lower level. Sorry, that sounds ageist, doesn't it? And sexist. Grandpa can sit down there as well. I'd like to propose that we accept the recommendation. Thank you.
You may wish to take a comment from Anne Collins, Chairman.
Before I do so, can I ask Katrina, what is the height difference between the two levels, please?
I'm afraid I don't have that information to hand. Chair, I apologise. I can only reflect on this. I can show you this photo again and the plan that is proposed. Let me bring that up a moment. So obviously this is the photo that's been added to the presentation. So you can see the three-step approach there. And then in terms of the plan, yes, it doesn't really, unfortunately, it doesn't really provide that much. I mean, half a meter, I would presume, approximately, maybe not. No, less than that. Yeah, less.
It is rather less than when it was first built because the sand level has risen since it was first built as well. So, you know, that and that's the nature of how it's going.
Okay. And I understand you wish to make a comment.
Yeah, Chair, I was just going to clarify, there is level access from the prom to the existing area of decking. So nobody is disadvantaged. There is access to that area. We are only talking actually about a very small additional area of decking, where I think in reality the difference is going to be 30 centimetres approximately at most probably. And if we were going to condition some kind of ramp, it would have to be within the existing red line area. So they would either lose a part of their existing decking, which is decking where people in wheelchairs can already sit, or they do lose part of their proposed decking. We wouldn't be able to condition a ramp off the beach per se, because that's not within the red line of their application area.
Thank you. Duly noted. I do have another speaker, and that's Councillor Louis O'Leary. Councillor O'Leary.
Yes, thank you, Chairman. I'm not going to get in the debate about inches and et cetera. There's ample access for the disabled users of this, as Ms. Collins has just suggested. I don't think a ramp would be necessary. I also don't think it's the responsibility of the business to provide access to the beach for disabled people. That would be the responsibility of the local authority. Therefore, I would like to second Councillor Weller in proposing this.
Okay, right. Okay, so that's the technical questions. Are there any other questions? We've got a proposal and which has been duly seconded. Are there anyone else wishing to speak? Okay. Over to you, Councillor Kimber.
Thanks, Chair. Katrina did put forward a suggestion to look at this with the owner or the applicant. I think that should be taken up. I think we're in a difficult area. We're bordering on the right of the disabled. I know it's very easy for us able-bodied to say we can walk up on, back on, further around to the Esplanade and come down that way. But when somebody's with their family, it might be seen as part of that day out. So I suggest we accept Katrina's suggestion that it could be looked at. Thank you.
Katrina, I'd like to come back to you on that comment, please.
Just as reflected before, that, you know, we could seek to delegate authority to the service manager of development management and enforcement, subject to the agreement of, you know, discussing a ramp over that one of those steps to enable all users to be able to use the lower tier of decking before obviously going forward with a decision on this application.
And over to you, Ms. Collins.
Chair, we could in theory delegate authority to seek an amended plan. I think we need to be very clear about what we're actually trying to achieve as a committee. Are you looking for a ramp between the higher level and the lower level? In which case, as I've also already suggested, we'd probably actually significantly reduce base areas of decking. Or are you looking for a ramp from the lower level down onto the beach? If you're looking for both ramps, I suggest we wouldn't actually have any lower level of decking left by the time both were achieved within the red line of the application site.
Donna, Are you continuing with your interest in having a condition applied to include a ramp with an amendment?
I thought it was quite clear that Katrina did put a suggestion forward. Now it's now turning almost into almost impossible to undertake, which I think is particularly sad for the disabled. So I'll have to accept the proposal as it is. But I do note, if you would minute that concern. Thank you.
Duly noted.
Councillor Worth, Chairman.
Councillor Worth.
Yeah, thank you, Chairman. So I agree with the proposal. I think it is not necessary to have a ramp in this location. We are not talking about a ramp to the beach at any point. Beach access is already provided from the Esplanade for wheelchair users. There is a large area that is level with the Esplanade at this cafe anyway, which is, and this is a well-used cafe, I think we're only talking about an extension to the decking to facilitate more customers. I don't think that it will probably aid wheelchair users to be able to use the cafe more, because some of the customers that would sit up the top and take up that area will now move down to the lower level, and that will give greater access for those wheelchair users. So I don't think we need to condition anything to do with ramps for wheelchair access, because I think personally there is sufficient wheelchair access for customers visiting that cafe.
Councillor O'Leary.
Oh, I beg your pardon. Chair in this meeting. I agree with Councillor Worth. It ain't the responsibility of this gentleman who owns his business to provide access to the beach. That is the job, as we've discussed, by local authority. There's plenty of seating already for the disabled. If Councillor Well is happy to still propose the original proposal, then I'm happy to second, and can we please move to a vote?
Could I confirm that, please, Councillor Well?
Yes, Chairman. What I was going to say was I would not support exploring the use of a ramp. I do support the application as it stands.
Do you still wish to speak, Councillor Weller?
No.
That was it.
That's what I was going to say, that I'm still proposing the recommendation as it stands, but I would not support the exploration of a ramp.
Oh, well.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Following the debate and further information, I'm happy to support the proposal as well.
Okay. In that case, then, we've got a proposal for acceptance, duly seconded. I'll now put it to the vote or the show of hands. All those in favour? So how many is that?
Nine.
I get it. Are there any against? One.
And no abstentions.
No abstentions? No. Oh, thank you. We've now voted in favour with a majority of 9-4, the application, and 1 against, no abstentions. Therefore, this particular item is passed. Okay, that concludes the planning applications for today. We now take item 6 on the agenda, which is urgent items. I've had no prior notification of any items of business which are considered to be urgent pursuant to the Section 100B(4)(b) of the Local Government Act 1972. We now take item 7 on the agenda, exempt business. I've had no prior notification of any item viewed as likely to disclose exempt information within the meaning of paragraph 3 of Schedule 12A of the Local Government Act 1972 as amended. That concludes this particular meeting. Thank you very much for your endurance.
That's the first time we got applause.
Yeah.